Good morning. My name is Jim Birchfield, senior pastor here at First Presbyterian Church, Houston, and it's my great pleasure to be the first to welcome you to our worship service today. Before we begin our broadcast, I'd like to share a few things that we hope will improve your worship experience. First, we would love to know that you are here and if there are any ways that we can serve you. During today's service, our online pastor will join you in worship and be available to respond to any messages or questions that you might want to share online. If you're joining us on Facebook, please take a moment to like the service or to say hello. If you feel there is someone who might benefit from today's message, we encourage you to share it. If you're joining us from our website, you can complete a connection card, view today's bulletin, or share a need via our live prayer button. Finally, if you're a member of the FPC community or just want to contribute to the ongoing ministry initiatives of our church, you can give online or via text by clicking our Give Online button. Friends, I understand that this is a time when we may still seem far apart from one another. Please know that in this season, you are not alone. We are reminded that Christ is with us, that Christ is for us, and that Christ loves us. Remember that He promises us His peace, a peace we can own, and a peace that transcends all understanding. Your FPC family is with you and remains here to serve you. Please enjoy our service.
Welcome. Welcome to worship this morning. Whether you're joining us from your living room or from your phone, it is a privilege and a joy for us to worship with you together. Before we kick off with worship, hear this word from the scriptures from the book of 2 Corinthians, starting in verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our affliction so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. Our prayer for you this morning is that you would experience worship in such a way that you know the Father of all compassion, the God of all mercy is for you, He's with you, and He wants to bless you this morning as you commune with Him. Pastor Emmanuel now is going to pray for us as we kick off our time of worship.
Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for the privilege of coming and worshiping you. Father, whatever anxieties we may have, or worries or frustrations with things that are happening with us or around us, we, Father, place all of them at the foot of the cross and unburden ourselves at the foot of the cross so that we can pay attention to what you have to tell us today. Grant us an encounter with your living spirit, Father. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Today is the last week in our series of biblical justice sermons. So because today is the last week, we want to do something different. We want to first watch a video that talks about biblical justice, and then we will go to our worship. So here is the video.
If you were a praying mantis, it would be socially acceptable to devour your mate.
And if you're a honey badger, you have no regard for other animals. You don't care.
If you're a panda with twins, it's normal to abandon one to take care of the other.
But if humans do any of these things, we would call it wrong, unfair, or unjust.
Yeah, why is that? Why do humans care so much about justice?
Well, the Bible has a fascinating response to that question. On page one, humans are set apart from all other creatures as the image of God.
Yeah, God's representatives who rule the world by his definition of good and evil.
And this identity, it's the bedrock of the Bible's view of justice. All humans are equal before God and have the right to be treated with dignity and fairness no matter who you are.
And that would be nice if we all did that, but we know how the world really works.
And the Bible addresses that too. It shows how we are constantly redefining good and evil to our own advantage at the expense of others.
Yeah, self-preservation. And the weaker someone is, the easier it is to take advantage of them.
And so in the biblical story, we see this happening on a personal level, but also in families, and then in communities, and in whole civilizations that create injustice, especially towards the vulnerable. But the story doesn't end there. Out of this whole mess, God chose a man named Abraham to start a new kind of family. Specifically, Abraham was to teach his family to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice.
Yeah, doing righteousness, that's a Bible word I don't really use, but what comes to mind is being a good person.
But what does that even mean, being good? The biblical Hebrew word for righteousness is tzedakah, and it's more specific. It's an ethical standard that refers to right relationships between people. It's about treating others as the image of God.
With the God-given dignity they deserve.
And this word justice, it's the Hebrew word mishpat. It can refer to retributive justice.
Like if I steal something, I pay the consequences.
Exactly. Yet most often in the Bible, mishpat refers to restorative justice. It means going a step further, actually seeking out vulnerable people who are being taken advantage of and helping them.
Yeah, some people call this charity.
But mishpat involves way more. It means taking steps to advocate for the vulnerable and changing social structures to prevent injustice.
So justice and righteousness are about a radical, selfless way of life.
Yeah, and you find this idea all over the Bible. Like here, in the book of Proverbs, what does it mean to bring about just righteousness?
Open your mouth for those who can't speak for themselves.
And what do these words mean for the prophets, like Jeremiah?
Rescue the disadvantaged, and don't tolerate oppression or violence against the immigrant, the orphan, and the widow.
And like here, look in the book of Psalms.
The Lord God upholds justice for the oppressed, gives food to the hungry, and sets the prisoner free. But he thwarts the way of the wicked. Whoa, he thwarts the wicked?
Yeah, in Hebrew, the word wicked is rasha. It means guilty or in the wrong. It refers to someone who mistreats another human, ignoring their dignity as an image of God.
So justice and righteousness is a big deal to God.
Yes, it's what Abraham's family, the Israelites, were to be all about. They ended up as immigrant slaves, being oppressed unjustly in Egypt. And so God confronted Egypt's evil, declaring them to be rasha, guilty of injustice. And so he rescued Israel. But the tragic irony of the Old Testament story is that these redeemed people went on to commit the same acts of injustice against the vulnerable. And so God sent prophets who declared Israel guilty.
But they weren't the only ones. There's injustice everywhere.
Yeah, some people actively perpetrate injustice. Others receive benefits or privileges from unjust social structures they take for granted. And sadly, history has shown that when the oppressed gain power, they often become oppressors themselves.
So we all participate in injustice, actively or passively, even unintentionally. We're all the guilty ones.
And so this is the surprising message of the biblical story. God's response to humanity's legacy of injustice is to give us a gift, the life of Jesus. He did righteousness and justice, and yet he died on behalf of the guilty. But then God declared Jesus to be the righteous one when he rose from the dead. And so now Jesus offers his life to the guilty so that they too can be declared righteous before God, not because of anything they've done, but because of what Jesus did for them.
The earliest followers of Jesus experienced this righteousness from God, not just as a new status, but as a power that changed their lives and compelled them to act in surprising new ways.
Yeah, if God declared someone righteous when they didn't deserve it, the only reasonable response is to go and seek righteousness and justice for others.
This is a radical way of life, and it's not always convenient or easy. It's courageously making other people's problems my problems.
This is what Jesus meant by loving your neighbor as yourself. It's about a lifetime commitment fueled by the words of the ancient prophet Micah. God has told you, humans, what is good, and what the Lord requires of you is to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God.
When we gather in worship, one of the important functions of worship is to renew covenant with God, renewing covenant with God. That includes looking at the last week and realizing where we failed to live up to the standards by which, even in Christ, God calls us to for our good. So let's confess our sins. Let's confess those areas now where we failed to live up to the covenant in Jesus. Let me pray for us. Father God, we come to you this morning in need of forgiveness, in need of renewal. We need to come clean. We've been more ready to resent than to forgive, more ready to manipulate than to serve, more ready to fear than to love, more ready to keep our distance than to welcome, more ready to compete than to help. This last week, we have been hostile to others, whether it was an unthinking word of anger to a loved one, a self-righteous or indignant remark to a colleague, or a passive-aggressive signaling of our virtue to make ourselves feel superior to others on our social media, we have refused to give peace to others. At the root of this behavior is mistrust and unfettered and uncontrolled, self-indulged anxiety. We do not love one another as we should, because we do not believe that you love us as you do. We have no peace in our hearts for anyone, because we functionally do not believe that your peace to us in Christ is enough. We have made you small. We have thought of you as weak. We have made ourselves gods of our own fiefdoms, and we admit that we've made a mess of it. We agree with you that we need a savior. We know that you want better for us. In fact, you have better for us. We are sorry that we don't believe you. And so this morning, we come before you and plead that for the sake of your Holy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we might delight in your will and walk in your way to the glory of your holy name. Please spend a few moments confessing your sins silently to God. Father, we confess all these sins to you, and we ask in Jesus' name that you forgive us all our sins. Amen. Friends, we don't confess to hate ourselves. We confess because sin mars relationship. And like a good father, God wants relationship with us. He wants us to grow up. He wants us to mature. And even when we act like rebellious children before God, even when we are unfaithful, Jesus, our older brother, is always faithful. He takes the heat for us. And it's on his authority that I can declare to you, in his name, as far as the east is from the west, your sins, confessed or unconfessed, known or unknown, are forgiven. They're totally forgiven, and you are being made whole. That is good news. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you. God has just given us his peace in Jesus, and now we get the chance to express that peace to one another. So whether you're at home, and you're with your family, give them peace. Whether you're alone, text someone and give them peace. And here's a thought. Think of someone you don't have peace with. Think of someone you don't have peace with. And maybe, because God has given you peace in Jesus Christ, you can take a step of courage to extend that peace to them. May the peace of Christ be with you.
My heart.
The philosopher Plato wrote a book called The Republic. And in that book, he said, if somebody is poor and they are sick, he said, it's better to let them die instead of giving them medical care, because they're not that useful to the society anyways, and resources are better used elsewhere. You see, that's the Roman world people were living in when Christianity was growing. What Christianity did is Christianity turned this ethic upside down. Anytime a village or a town had a plague, the Roman officials would leave the village. The rich people would leave the village. But ultimately, it'll be the poor people that are left by the roadside to suffer and die in the pandemic. The Christians that were there would leave behind a few people to take care of the weak, the marginalized, the oppressed, as they are dying. And sometimes, some Christians would die with them. You see, this created a sense of a pull of people looking at that and saying, how is it that these Christians care about these people so much that they're even willing to die for them? Alan Kreider wrote a book called The Patient Ferment of the Early Church. He says this kind of advocacy of Christians, selfless advocacy on behalf of the people that were poor, created a pull of people coming closer to investigate what's going on here. How are these people able to exhibit this kind of selfless advocacy for the poor? And that's what led a lot of people to become Christians. And the Roman Empire, which was against Christianity, in a matter of three centuries, itself became a Christian empire. I'm talking about this because today's topic is advocacy. Since the beginning of the year, we've been on this series about biblical justice. We've been looking at different topics from generosity to equality to individual responsibility to corporate responsibility. And as we finish the series, we want to look at the topic of advocacy. When we look at the Bible, there are so many passages, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, that talk about the command for us to be advocates for people that need protection. We are going to look at two passages today, one from Isaiah and another from Matthew chapter 25. So Isaiah chapter 1, verses 17 to 18. Isaiah chapter 1, reading from 17 onwards. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Defend the oppressed. Take up the cause of the fatherless. Plead the case of the widow. Come now, let us settle this matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, though they shall be white as snow, though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. Matthew 25, reading from verse 35 onwards. For I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, you invited me in. I needed clothes, you clothed me. I was sick, you looked after me. I was in prison, you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes to clothe you? When did we see you sick or go to the prison to visit you? The king will reply, truly, I tell you, whatever you did for the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did them for me. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You see, in the chapter that I read on Isaiah, that is something that Isaiah proclaims to the people of Israel as Babylon is becoming a powerful empire in the east, ready to take over Israel. There is a theologian called Goldingay. He says, what is interesting to note about this passage is that God is talking about justice. And when he's talking about justice, he doesn't talk about justice in the sense of don't commit murder, don't steal, don't covet. He's not talking about justice in the sense of Ten Commandments framework. Rather, he's saying justice is to defend the oppressed. Justice is to protect the people that are weak, that are marginalized, that are oppressed within our midst. Why is God calling that justice? The clue for that is actually in verse 18, where he says, the Lord says, come now, let us settle this matter. There are some translations that would say, come, let us reason. And Goldingay says, when God says, come, let us settle this matter, what God is doing is he is using covenantal language. God is bringing a covenantal lawsuit against Israel. God is saying, you have been in covenant with me, and I graciously invited you into this covenant with me. But now, because of your works, you are unfaithful to this covenant. So I am bringing a lawsuit against you. To understand what's going on here, we kind of have to step back to see, when did this covenant actually start? This covenant that God established with Israel started in Deuteronomy. In Deuteronomy, when Moses was establishing the covenant with God and explaining it to people, in chapter 24, God tells to the Israelites, remember, you were oppressed in Egypt. Remember, you were the people that were marginalized in Egypt. I had grace on you to redeem you from Egypt, and I have brought you into this covenant to take you into the land of milk and honey. So on your part, remember that you were someone for whom I advocated on your behalf. So when you have people in your midst who need protection, who are poor, who are weak, who are oppressed, you have to be their advocates. You have to bring justice to them. You see, that's the part of covenant. God could have left the Israelites in Egypt, but no, he didn't. He went and said, I am bringing you out of my grace. I am bringing you out to redeem you so that you would go and be an advocate for other people that are oppressed in your midst. You see, what's happening here is Israel is enjoying the land that God has given them, but they have forgotten that they are supposed to bring justice to the people that are oppressed. In fact, in Deuteronomy 24, God says, when you harvest your fields, leave a little bit for the poor people to come and get. Don't harvest all of your crop. That is a way of bringing justice to the people around you. And they had completely forgotten about this. They had forgotten to be faithful to the gracious covenant to which God had invited them. And that's why God says, hey, come on here. Let's talk about this. Let's settle this matter. Why are you not taking care of the poor, the marginalized, and the oppressed within your midst? What's the principle here? See, the principle here is this. Our acts of advocacy for the sake of the poor, the oppressed, and the marginalized within our midst does not come from our own sense of benevolence or our own sense of, oh, we are good people. It comes ultimately because God was our advocate when we were the ones that were oppressed. The origin of our acts of advocacy to protect the people that are weak is God's advocacy on our behalf. You see, that's where advocacy starts when we look at the biblical point of view. this verse gives us a glimpse of what God's heart is after: to protect the weak, to take care of the marginalized, to bring justice to the oppressed. You see, the same theme that is there in the Old Testament also comes in the New Testament. In Matthew 25, when Jesus talks about whatever you do to the least of these, you do them to me. He's bringing the same principle of saying, take care of the people that are weak and vulnerable. In fact, Jesus is not just saying, take care of them because they're made in the image of God. He's saying, take care of them the way you would want to take care of me. He's even increasing the ante up. Mother Teresa was from Albania in Europe. She left her comfortable place there to go to India to serve the people that were living on the streets. She went to the city called Calcutta, which had a lot of people living on the streets. A number of them were lepers. She would go, clean them up, bathe them, bandage their wounds, and give them a sense of dignity. That is how her ministry there started. And then her ministry grew because more and more people came and became fellow advocates on her behalf. And she started a whole convent in Calcutta. When she was interviewed, an interviewer once asked her, hey, when I think about helping these people that are lepers, that have wounds in their bodies, that is bleeding because they don't have sensitivity to know that there is a wound because their nervous system is affected, how do you find within yourself to go and find the strength to go and help these people, to touch them, and to bandage them, to bathe them? And Mother Teresa just smiled and said, oh, that's so easy. I just think of them as, when I serve them, I think of serving Jesus Christ. You see, because Jesus Christ died for my sins. And it is out of this joy of salvation that when I serve these people, I think of serving Jesus Christ. You see an important point here? The important point is the fuel for our selfless advocacy comes from this deep joy of salvation. And that was the same in the Roman Empire too, when Christians were being persecuted. Dionysius was a bishop in Alexandria in 260 AD. And there was a plague in Alexandria. Again, the same thing happened. All of the rich people left and the Roman officials left. But the church left behind a few people to take care of the people that were dying. And Dionysius, Bishop Dionysius, in his letters says, the Christians that stayed behind with a serene sense of happiness, with a serene sense of cheerfulness, in which they said, we are serving Jesus in serving these people. We know our eternity is secure because of the work of Jesus. It is out of that joy that they served these people. They became advocates for these people. And some of these Christians died in the process. You see, this sense of the fuel for our advocacy coming from a place of deep joy in Jesus, because Jesus died for us on the cross and released us from the burden of sin. That kind of joyous motivation for advocacy is what separates Christian sense of advocacy from secular versions of advocacy. That is very unique about Christianity. And that is why you see all these early Christians going and performing selfless acts of advocacy on behalf of the poor in the name of Jesus. Now, sometimes we may feel, I don't just feel the sense of joy, right? Sometimes we may feel, when we think about advocacy, we may feel afraid. We may think, okay, how much am I supposed to give? There is so much need in the world. sometimes we may even feel a sense of empathy overload, right? How long can I keep giving? Right? That kind of fear and anxiety is human. I empathize with that fear and anxiety. And I want to say three things to that. One, the gospel never operates in a place of fear and anxiety. When we are talking about advocacy for the poor, advocacy for the marginalized and the oppressed, if that brings a sense of anxiety in you, what I would say is, don't think about that. Rest in the love of Jesus. You see, ultimately, our acts of advocacy has to be fueled by our joy in Jesus. Ultimately, our acts of advocacy has to come from this place in which we look at Jesus on the cross, dying because he loved us. And that resting in that love is what brings us the sense of joy to say, this is how much Jesus has loved me. And he has asked me to take care of the poor and the oppressed around me. How can I do that? Right? So the first thing is, rest in the love of Jesus. Second, ask yourself, when you look at different injustices again happening around you, what is an injustice that just ticks you off? What is the injustice that just makes you feel, that's not how it should be? And pray about it. And in your everyday activities, try to address that in a Christ-like way. For me, one of the sense of small injustices that kind of makes me feel, is if I feel like somebody's being treated like an outsider in a community. And that's why anytime I do any form of a community group, I always try to go the extra mile to make sure nobody feels like they are an outsider in a group. So that's just one small thing. And if you don't know what ticks you off, just pray about it and ask God, God, what is it that is an aspect of injustice that you want me to pray about? And thirdly, do something small. John Chrysostom is a 4th century bishop in Constantinople. When he comments on Matthew 25 that we read a little bit earlier, he says, pay attention to this. God didn't go and tell people, you solved world hunger. God didn't tell these people, you cured all people. All Jesus says here is, when I was hungry, you came and gave me something to eat. When I was sick, you came to visit me. Be faithful in small acts of advocacy to the people that are hurting around you. And those small acts of everyday advocacy gives people a glimpse of God's love for them. You see, that's the goal of advocacy. The goal of Christ-like selfless advocacy is to give people a glimpse of God's love for them. This kind of advocacy is something that Christians do even today. This is not just something that happened in the first century. I was speaking with a missionary last year who works in one of the refugee camps in Eastern Europe that has people from the Middle East fleeing the wars and instability there. And this person is there and serving all of these people in the refugee camp and builds a relationship with the people there. And at some point, the people that are in the refugee camp ask her, hey, you lived a comfortable life in your home. Why did you leave all of that and come here to be in the midst of this squalor among us? And that gave her an opportunity to say, because Jesus loved me. Because Jesus loved me, he has asked me to go and serve the people around the world in his name. And that's why I'm here serving you. On Sundays, when they have Sunday services in this refugee camp, their church is overflowing. You see, when we do acts of selfless advocacy, coming from a place of joy in the Lord, that points people to the love of Jesus. And that brings people into God's kingdom. So, the source of our advocacy is not our own sense of benevolence or goodness. It is God's advocacy on our behalf. The fuel for our advocacy is the joy of salvation in our Lord Jesus Christ. It is because he died for us on the cross, because he loves us so much, we are willing to go out and perform acts of selfless advocacy for the people around us. The goal of these selfless acts of advocacy is to give people a glimpse of God's love for them so they get invited into God's kingdom, so that ultimately God's name is glorified. Amen.
Would you pray with me? Father, we have heard your word. Thank you for your word. It is full of very good news. And we ask that you would now hear these prayers of intercession that we offer to you. Father, we admit that we are tired. We are weary. Each day that passes, whether it's the pandemic, or the economy, or the stock market, or a friend struggling, it only seems to pile on. It only seems to get worse. God, we are tired and we need help. As our society continues to fragment, help us hold together. Help us hold the center. Help us hold the middle. Whether it be in our families or our neighborhoods or this our church, help us to pull together. Help us not to be vindictive towards one another. Where there is anger and violence and frustration and grief, bring healing. Revive our imaginations to see a hopeful future. Hopeful because we know the end of all history. Help us to see our role in being embodied friends and neighbors and colleagues of hope. Help us to shrug off the cloak of cynicism and despair. Father, in Jesus' name, that we pray that your peace would reign in the world, starting in our own hearts. We pray for an end to war and strife and malice and envy. We ask that you would grant the leaders of our nation and the leaders of every country, whether peaceable or rogue, a great fear and reverence for your name and a great burden of responsibility to lead with integrity. We pray for peace regarding the many current crises around the world. Father, we pray for those who suffer in the sickness and the loneliness and the adversity of that violence. We pray specifically for your global church, that our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world would be protected. They would also be given freedom to take risks of love for the lost, the hurting, the enemy, the refugee. Father, we pray this evening for all those struggling at the end of the ropes, those despairing because of the pandemic, they are alone. We pray for the vulnerable and the elderly who are not able to leave their homes, for those who don't feel safe. We pray that you give them confidence in your very near presence through the visitation of your Holy Spirit. We pray for the sick, the homeless, the uprooted and the hurting of our own city, whether they are down the street here in a hospital bed or suffering in neglect. Father, in Jesus' name, protect them, defend them, the weak, the poor, the persecuted, the sick, the lonely. Keep them, bless them, and guard them. We pray for our leaders, the leaders of our church in the session and our pastors. We pray that you would give them wisdom as they continue to grapple with how to best glorify you in leading your people in this very hard time. And Lord, we do indeed pray for ourselves. Draw us into daily communion with your Son, that each day this week, we might grow in all goodness, lead lives of patience and service, and become self-forgetful in the great mission of your reconciliation given to us here, the work of your people on earth. And so, Lord, in your mercy, hear these prayers. Hear these prayers that we've shared. Hear the private ones that we have not shared. And hear us now together as we pray out loud wherever we are, the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, worship continues, so please join us as we continue to worship God today.
Are you hurting, broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. And we'll come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, now come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior, isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah.
Thank you for joining us in worship this morning. It's been a privilege to be with you, to worship God together. Immediately following the service, there will be some announcements that flash on your screen. Please pay attention to those. And if you have any prayer requests, any need to talk to a pastor or talk to any one of us, please reach out to the church and we'll make sure that we attend to those things. Thank you for joining us. And now Pastor Emmanuel is going to give us a benediction.
You are God's beloved. Even as we go out of here, let us remember God has blessed us in Jesus so that we can be a blessing to the people around us. Now go forth in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. you.